Welcome to the school board workshop of October the 26th. If you'd all rise for a moment of silence in the pledge.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first item is public input. Ms. Challenger, do we have any cards? Okay, thank you. Dr. Moxley.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our board meeting. We have several items on the agenda. This is a workshop, so all these items are for information only. And some of the items are on the agenda tonight for you to take action, and we'll be able to work through any questions that you might have on any of those items. There is one correction I would like to make to the agenda today. 3.05, that is supposed to be the strategic plan. So that's the overarching strategic plan. The strategic finance plan will be coming at a later time. So I do want you to know that we'll be dealing with a strategic plan. So with that, our first item is to receive an update on the Care Here Wellness Center. And Mrs. McLeod and Mr. Ritter are here, and they will be giving you an update and then some next steps and plans for the future.
Thank
so
you.
Ms. McLeod.
The PowerPoint that I gave to you was one that we did back in May that was on the agenda, and we went over it briefly during the budget process. What we wanted to do really today was to focus in on the next steps that were included in that one.
Hold on. Do you need copies, Ms. Luke?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Ms. Challenger, do you have an extra copy of this?
Ma'am?
Here you
yes,
go.
Ma'am.
She's right behind us. They can't hear you in the back. Is that
no.
what they said?
B's telling me I need to speak into the mic. Better?
Can you hear now, B?
Can
okay.
You thank you. Anyway, we went through this and we reviewed our claims history, and what we've seen is that we've had tremendous success with our wellness centers. That success has been helped by the cooperation in both of our unions and all of our employees. What we run into effectively is that we are now ready for the fourth one. And that's part of what the update is for, is that on tonight's agenda is the renewal of our contract with Care Here. That was written originally with a renewal contract provision included, like many of ours are. And because of the relationship we have with them and with Blue Cross and the success of these centers, we want to move it forward. They are also in that thing, in the agenda, offering to assist us in purchasing the building that will become the fourth center. So that's a win for both of us, for all of us. And we just wanted to make sure that you had seen it. You knew where we had, it is intended to sit on the site next to the Title I buildings that are down on the offside site of Claremont Elementary. That piece of property is not set for any other use in the 5 and 10 year capital plan. It is not a student-based site. So as with all of our other ones, some of the other districts that have these wellness centers have placed them on school location. We had kind of had conversation early on and in continuing that because of some of the Jessica Lunsford provisions, if it was a non-student site, it's simply easier. We don't have to deal with any of that. Because while all of our employees are cleared, you could have the event where a dependent wasn't. And rather than have to even have that conversation, being on a non-student site takes that off the table and we don't have to deal with it. So we have that on the agenda for you tonight. I notified our employees that 317 plan, there was a larger increase on it this year during our open enrollment. We have notified all of the participants that it will no longer be offered after this year. That was the plan that on an individual basis we were taking in considerably less than we were paying out. And the other plan was just the opposite. So the combination of moving the employees away from that expensive plan to the regular plan and providing additional time and service by having that fourth center open should bring us to a place next year where when we come around to renewals, if we have an increase, it will not be a large one. And again, we are still so far under for the last 5 years what other school districts and other companies and businesses have been hit with in health insurance costs. This has been a phenomenal success, and our biggest problem is not having enough appointments available. So this will help one piece of that.
Okay. Yes, sir.
And I don't participate in the medical program. I have my own group plan in my office, and I have 15 employees. Mm-hmm. And I pay $100 more per month than the spouse with children. This is 317, mm-hmm. which I'm not sure how that relates to. It just seems like with a system as large as ours, there would be a larger difference.
Well, that's our expensive plan. If you go down to our less expensive plan, this is the first part of it is, which page are you on? I'm sorry.
They're not numbers.
Charge. Okay.
This is also, we did the over the 12 months, the 20 days. We do it obviously as a 20-pay deduction. Our spouse and one of the things we'll be looking at in the next year is that our spouse and children coverage, we're not sure that may not need to be adjusted. We're looking at it now through usage, because when we became self-funded several years ago, we started off with where the premiums were with Blue Cross, and we're working through a process with them now to see where, if we were fully funded like we were, where the premiums would land. Then we kind of back out all the administrative costs to figure out where our premium should be, to make sure that we're doing, that those are adjusted for the folks that are using it. And because we're self-funded, this is now a process that where Blue Cross had done it for us when they were calculating premiums, because we don't technically calculate premiums anymore. It's a process that we have to be more involved in now.
And I also think the 3359 is probably the most common plan. So I don't know how which one compares to yours.
Actually, this one is the closest, and it's interesting because I thought I was looking up here, but at the rate, this is almost exactly what I'm paying.
Oh,
with 15 employees versus we have 5,000. You know what I'm saying?
So, well, we'd have to go through the coverages too. Our plans, quite frankly, are quite rich.
Yeah. Well, this so is.
It could be.
That's all.
And I think don't they do a real look at the claims and all that when they come up with
the
risks?
Yes.
I mean with the rates as well.
The other piece of conversation that we just wanted to go over with you was Lauren prepared a no-show report. Mm-hmm. That is the other problem that is caused by the fourth facility will help, but when we have excessive no-shows, that takes that opportunity that. Appointment availability away from somebody else who's trying to get it.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
If you get, you got to almost eat it.
Really close. Okay. All right. The first couple of slides here were prepared by Care Here and just showed. Just to give us an idea of how many no-shows that we have. And I'm not going to go into too much detail on those. Carol, can you advance to the one before there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's been a problem.
On this one, this is just showing the trend of how many no-show appointments we're having each month. And you can see that it's pretty steady. We have not seen very much improvement in that. And on to the next one. So we went through and we did a really deep analysis on the no-show appointments. And our current process to try to reduce the number of no-shows was that each patient receives an email reminder before the appointment. The day before, the staff actually calls them to remind them of the appointment. And if someone misses an appointment without canceling it, then we follow up and send them a letter saying, please don't do that anymore. It's really inconsiderate and other people can't use that appointment slot, and we have not had very much effect with that. So over the past year, we went through an analysis, and 32 patients missed 3 or more appointments, 10 patients missed 4 or more appointments, 1 patient, 6 appointments, and 1 patient, 12 appointments, because there's just no consequences to no-showing your appointments, and it's a problematic trend, as you can see. And one of the issues is not that the appointments aren't just a 20-minute slot, but a lot of these appointments are back-to-backs, like a well-woman visit is actually 4 appointment slots. So that's 60 minutes of a physician's time that they're not able to provide services. So of those in the past year, 243 20-minute appointment slots were missed. 81 hours of the physician's time are almost $15,000 if you take an average of $60 per appointment. So based on that, what we would like to do is, effective January 1st, implement a no-show fee. And we've presented this a couple of times to the Insurance Advisory Committee, and they've been fully supportive of this proposal. So we would make sure that we get the word out as best we can, put it on the websites, and notice out in a newsletter, post it in all of the wellness centers. And what we're proposing is that, you know, we understand everybody's going to miss an appointment every now and then. It happens to all of us. So the first time you miss an appointment, we send out a letter. Second no-show appointment, you get a stronger letter. The third time, we send out an invoice for $25. Fourth no-show appointment, and this is in a rolling six-month calendar. The fourth one, an additional $25 invoice will be sent to the patient, and any funds that we collect will deposit back into the health and wellness center budget. So that's what we want to start doing on January 1st to help, hopefully put a curb to an end to these excessive no-shows.
Roseanne?
You have come before us before, and we've had similar issues that mm-hmm. you are sharing with us again today. One, I think that we're too lenient with this. I don't know if anyone has had an opportunity to call any of these people who missed more than 5 appointments. I do use the center. And, you know, I go on and I look for available appointments, and they do call the day before. They send you a reminder email. And so there are opportunities to be able to remind somebody, and to then also for the individual say, you know what, I'm not going to be able to make it tomorrow. So I would like to see these first no-show, a warning letter sent. Second, $25. And then third, they're suspended for 6 months. Because some people are only going once every 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months. So it would be interesting, these people who have missed, you know, consecutive appointments, why? And I mean, I don't expect you and your staff to go and then make all these phone calls and try to track people down and find out why aren't you showing. But if you had any idea, if you've heard from any of these people, but that would be my recommendation.
Okay, other board members?
Part of this is we bring it back to the board, because it will be a fee schedule. We'll have to bring it back to the board on an agenda item. This is just a workshop area. But in doing so, and we've talked about this before, we'll need to set up an authorization for the employee when they sign up to use the wellness center that they've been notified of this. We'll have to work this through the attorney's office. And that when those no-show things are invoiced, that we can do payroll deduction for it. Because I also can't have my staff chasing folks around trying to be a collection agent.
No, but I'm again, fine with that, but I think
acknowledgement up front by the employee that they understand if we get to this point and that you do get the invoice, that it would be payroll deducted.
Well, you do that in a doctor's office, so
well,
it's the same thing.
I'm saying, because it's a fee, we still have to bring it back to the board. So this is just the conversation we needed to have with you all before we bring that to you.
Okay. Mark?
I could have sworn I remember seeing an email go out ages ago that there was going to be a no-show fee put in place. But I'm struggling on the history on that.
We and I'll look to them to fill in some of the gaps. We did bring something. It's been probably a year ago, and it did not get approved at that time. So it was a proposal on the table.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We had a board member that did.
So there was conversation about it, but it did not get implemented.
And the question really kind of circled back around
how
didn't want to getting into the collection agent business.
Right.
And so in kind of backing up and saying, okay, how do we do this right? How do we do this effectively? It is that we have to set it up on the front end and make sure that the employee slash patient understands fully that, you know, if you do this, this is the consequence, and you're signing that not only do you understand it, but you authorize it.
Yeah. So I guess that email must have been sent premature or something. I mean,
I don't know
the way
the
it was
email
sent to employees was
to.
That this is being implemented, but then it, but you say it wasn't.
It was not implemented.
It was a proposal at that time.
Okay. And this is strictly for people who don't even call about their appointment. They just completely miss it. They don't cancel it.
Correct.
So what is the cancellation period that would help them avoid this?
That thing is online.
Yeah.
It's real time.
Yeah.
So if you have an appointment at 1 o'clock and at 12:30 you cancel it and Roseanne happens to be looking at it at 12:35, she could grab that appointment.
So I could really cancel it literally minutes before
and not
even fall into
yes,
this
you wouldn't,
trap.
Because you would have taken the action to do it.
Yeah,
that's correct.
Yes.
And also the Wellness Center staff, they get phone calls throughout the day, like, can you please work
me
in?
Yeah, of course.
We'll call you if somebody can.
Never an appointment.
So if they knew, they could say, yeah, can you be here at 1? I mean, could work you in.
Well, based on all that information, it seems like this is way too generous. And I'm with you. I mean, to say in 6 months, just a rolling 6 month period, somebody could no show without even canceling three times and only be subjected to $25. I mean, that just doesn't even compare to the private sector. What's happening out there? This is just
nope. For some support and
this is just way too generous in my mind.
Thank you, Stephanie.
No, I agree. I was even when you were talking about 6 months rolling calendar, like. It'd be interesting to see how many of these would be 6 months later and they miss another one and then they're not even falling into it. So I'm good with that.
Good with Roseanne's suggestion. On
yes.
I'm going to follow the lead. We don't, to Roseanne's comment, do we have a profile of what happened for those that are chronic? Is it because they're so ill they couldn't get there?
No, I don't think so. I think it's that we see very few no-shows on Saturdays. We see them during the week, during the workday, and I think people just like, oh, I have to go to a meeting. And they just blow off the appointment. Or they
instead of getting on the computer or calling.
And canceling it, yes, yes. And also, it's not that many people that are the repeat offenders. It's a smaller group.
That are multiple offenders.
Yes.
But if we have them sign this information up front, then they know it, and
that's
just going to happen.
Talk to Mr. Johnson before about it, and we'll work with Steve or Mark to make sure that before we do this, when we get the fee approved for the board, we'll also have the notification so that, again, it's very clear to the employees what we're doing.
So we're going to have three no-show appointment items.
But it seems like
the third one you're off.
That the if we lost 14, was it 14,500?
15,
yes.
Yeah.
If the amount is $60 per appointment,
mm-hmm.
why wouldn't the no-show fee be $60?
Well, we were not trying to be as.
That's where I would go with it. I would go with, we've lost the time. I mean, that's.
Why don't we see how this works first?
Or make it progressive.
And if it, yes.
25 and then go to 60.
And if they don't adhere to it, then we go up.
And do a higher fee for the.
Right.
And if I may interject, we also need to, you know, balance a fine line of pushing the employees back out of the system to their private
positions. Yeah, we don't
want to
do that.
Which are more expensive. So.
We want them to come to
it's
going to
be
centers.
A more expensive no-show at the private
exactly.
sector.
Exactly. We want them to come,
yes.
but if they're not canceling appointments, then that's somebody else that can't come. And when our worst problem really that we are continuing to run into is people can't get appointments. Again, that's what we realized and identified the need for the fourth center. And when they did the analysis of where the folks are not coming from, it's right where we're trying to put it. So we believe it should be in a – that one's probably going to be overrun very quickly.
Well, I subscribe to Roseanne and Mark with a warning first time. However, then I would step it and go 25, then 60 to me. That's where I would land.
If they, you said you were going to get an authorization up front. If they refuse to authorize the direct.
I keep the
okay, that's what I was wondering.
It is a benefit to our employees. It is
warning,
only for our folks
60,
that are enrolled
suspended.
In the plan.
Okay.
And that would be part of the plan.
Not just 25
okay.
suspended.
We did poll a lot of the other school districts that use Care Here for their wellness centers and how they were addressing the no-show fees, and it was a bit of a legal stumbling block to get past the payroll deduction piece,
mm-hmm.
and that's why we thought it might
be
easier if we just start out invoicing and then work on that.
Well, can they pay with a credit card?
No, because we're not. I don't think we're set up here to accept credit cards.
Could we be set up to take credit cards?
Those are what we need to do between now and then. And this is why we're just bringing it to you to have the conversation now, so that we can find out what kind of things we need to get put in place, so that we can activate it.
We only got 2 months.
It won't take.
Okay, Stephanie.
So if they don't authorize it up front, and you or they authorize it up front, and then you invoice them, and they don't pay it again, will they lose their privileges? Do they have so many days to pay the? Do you know what I'm saying?
And
if we're gonna
we want to find a way to do it so that it can be through payroll deduction, because we don't want to get into the collection activity. That's not something we want to have to be spending our time or theirs doing.
And we've talked about this since we opened up these clinics. So.
The $14,500 on this page, that's just for these people who have missed three or more appointments. Right. So really, the actual loss is probably much higher, right? Because anybody who's missed two or even just one appointment, that's not factored
in. This was looking a bit chronic.
Wow.
Okay, so the staff goes back with the right and knows exactly what we're all doing instead of us shaking our heads here.
First no-show gets a warning letter.
Right.
Second no-show gets a $25 fee, whether that's invoiced or payroll deduction will work.
Right.
Third one is a $50 fee.
$60 fee. And the fourth is you're out for 6 months. Okay. Is everybody good with that?
Yes.
Don't shake your head. Say yes.
Yes.
And we will bring that back to you.
Be healed.
Well, I had a request from a staff member that we needed to say what we think instead of shaking our heads. Okay.
Do you have any other questions that we can ask?
Anything else?
I would just like to say that these centers,
they're wonderful,
serve a great benefit to our employees and their family members, and it is a one-stop shop.
We have contained our health care costs. I mean, we've had small increases the last couple of years, and we'll probably have a small one next year, but our 2% and 3%, and for 2 years we had nothing, are nothing compared to what.
Nope.
But I think it's also given our employees an opportunity to go and seek medical attention, whereas many of them did not want to make an appointment, go sit in an office for
time off,
you know, hours on end.
That's why we refer to them always as wellness centers. Part of that is getting folks to have preventative care. I mean, we can't put a dollar amount on that. We know it exists. But did that appointment, you know, head off hypertension that, you know, got you on the right medication that headed off a heart attack or something? You know, we can't put a dollar amount on that. We know it's there.
But also, there is no wait. When you walk in
wonderful.
And your appointment is at 8:20, and a lot of times they're taking you back before 8:20 to go ahead and run your vitals. So,
okay, I'm just going to make one more comment, and then we're going to move on because your 15 minutes is up. Roseanne, this is one of the better things that you and I have done since we have been here, going to this program for everybody, and I just want to thank you for being on board with that, and the board now for being on board with keeping it going, because I came over from the other count, from the other side of town, and this is a much better plan than what they have. It's better for our employees. So.
Well, we're bigger, and we do have the ability to do something.
And we should.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I'm back. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Just sit there. The next item is the Education Foundation request. I'm going to invite Carmen Cullen-Batt to please come up to the table and join Carol McLeod. Board members, you have two documents. You have a presentation that Carmen's going to walk us through, and then you have the staffing request in a chart, and then Carol can talk to you about any budget questions you might have. So we'll turn it over to Carmen.
Forgive my appearance. I am working in a field today.
So are we.
The first slide in front of you here shows a revenue history, an asset history from the Education Foundation. Back in 2005, the foundation, this was my first year, we went from $189,000 to $305,000, and we thought we were doing something incredible. At that point in time, we had two staff members, and you'll see that the orange and yellow lines are on top of each other until we get to 2014 because of the Gates grant. But we had a steady increase. We added in 2007 a third staff member, and that staff member was in charge of special events. And in that year, we had a $250,000 increase to our bottom line. And again, these revenues are taken from the actual audits from those years. You will note, you're going too fast already. You'll note when we hit the Gates grant in 2014, that was an $840,000 grant, and our revenues hit right at $2 million. And so for the sake of apple-to-apple comparisons, I have pulled that Gates grant out, and you'll follow the yellow line. And we added the fourth staff member in that year, and we saw a $396,000 increase during that year with that fourth staff member. Our assets, you'll see we've gone from, you know, $250,000, and we're riding well over $4 million now. The spike in 2009 was when we determined that we should be including our scholarships in our assets. So the spike in the assets is scholarship dollars for the Florida prepaid. When you look at how we compare, and the source that I used is the Consortium of Central Florida, of Florida Education Foundations. It's a biennial survey that's done each year. So these numbers are for 13 and 14. And when you look at how we compare in FTEs between 40,000 and 49,000, and look at the revenues that we're generating, Lake County falls second to the very rich Collier County in school districts with an FTE between 40 and 49,000. We rank second in that. This next slide shows the average dollar per staff member generated based on FTE. And you'll see that Lake is ranking third. We're right under Sarasota and Escambia. And we're bringing in right at 168. Escambia's in at 179, and Sarasota is in at 180. So we are right there. The other, and obviously beating out Marion County and Collier County. The one thing that is not a true identifier in this is based on six staff members, because we have Take Stock. And since Take Stock does generate a little bit of revenue, these are calculated with six employees. However, it's very important to know that Take Stock and Children employees cannot do any single foundation function. They are strictly dealing with Take Stock and Children. Then we wanted to look at how we're comparing in Central Florida, and we again have revenues and FTEs. And you'll note that Seminole County is blowing everybody away with over $3 million a year. Osceola is doing quite well, but we are still outranking Orange County and Marion County in dollars raised. Okay, this again shows the average dollar per staff member versus Central Florida. And in that slide, we are ranking number two on average dollar per staff. And you'll see that Seminole County obviously is still not ranking. Your next shows the actual dollars in Central Florida that are raised. And again, I'll bring up my point. Ours is divided by six employees, because Take Stock and Children do generate some revenue. So to keep it a true comparison, some of these, Orange County, for example, does not have Take Stock and Children. And so you're looking at, we're bringing in right at $168,000 per staff member. Then we need to look at Take Stock, because my request today is twofold, one for foundation and one for Take Stock. Currently in Marion County, there are 207 students in high school. We have 185 students in high school. They are operating their 207 with a staff of four. We are operating 185 kids with a staff of 2.5. What we feel that the foundation needs to, we are past capacity at this point. And in order for us to maintain and grow, we would like to add a position for a community donor liaison. We that position would be, obviously, any position in the foundation is there to increase revenue. And the way that we are looking at that position, that they would be stewards of our donors and to help build our donor database. We have over 500 volunteers in the foundation, and we found a very slap-in-the-face statistic last year when we only had a 15% return at the Renaissance Fair. This is pure indication that we're not stewarding our volunteers, and we don't have the time with the current staff that we have. And then, obviously, our social media, which is critical to foundation success. The district impact would be $30,967. And I will note that when we had the fourth position that was added last year in 2014, the district agreed to pay the benefits. The foundation agreed to pay the salary. And that did occur until Linda Ford left us. So that position has been dark since July. And what we have found is that we cannot, with the dollars of the way they flow through the foundation, there are so many of our dollars that are restricted. We do not have enough of an unrestricted base to fund a full salary. And that's what we ran into in this past year. The grant dollars that come in, you can't just pay somebody's salary, and there are very few, if any, grants out there that are going to fund a salary. So this is what has left us in such jeopardy, is the use of unrestricted and restricted dollars. As far as the take stock position, this would be a mentor student advocate position, which went dark about 4 years ago, and we hired part-time foundation employees, and with the increase in kids to 185 kids that we are monitoring and 185 mentors that we have to reach out to, we need to bring back that full-time position. These dollars are provided by the state, so there's absolutely no impact to the district. They fund salary funds, state and benefits, or salary and benefits.
Going back to the foundation position, you're saying that the district impact would be $30,967. Does that include benefits?
No, you currently have allocated between $11,000 and $12,000 in benefits, which we have not been accessing since July.
Okay, all right.
And I tried to work through it because we have this conversation every year when we do the staffing plan. Each one of these positions is a little bit different. And that accounting specialist, currently we split the salary with the foundation and we pay all the benefits. And another position, we pay all the salary and they pay all the benefits. And a third position, we pay the salary and they pay the benefits. So we were trying to work through, it's like, okay, if we move this here, what are we paying now? So that we could come up with a net change to the district. And that would be that we're actually moving the accounting specialist, that position will be gone. But if you'll follow the green box to the green box, the funding that we used for that will now fund the grant specialist.
Mm-hmm.
This is where it'll free up where we're already paying the benefits. So that's why she's showing the cost of the salary for the community liaison that we would be picking it up. We're already doing the benefits. What we're adding is the salary. The stake chop, take, I can't say that. Take stock in children, thank you, is effectively grant funded. It still comes through the district, but it's a district employee, but as with our other grant fundings, they can pick up both salary and benefits, so there is no additional cost to the district. It does come out of the take stock.
Where would funds come from? Out of the general?
General fund.
And what do we have in the general fund?
At this moment, I can't give you an honest answer. We have just done our October FTE count. We have reported an increase in enrollment beyond what we were budgeted for at the beginning, which we knew. And as soon as we get that in the third calculation, I will have a straight answer for you.
Okay.
It will be higher. I'm not evading you. I'm just telling you that with right now with the state, I can't give you a number.
Okay.
But we have had an increase in enrollment, so there will be dollars added to our budget.
But we're just positive.
Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry.
But it would be out of that increased revenue that would fund this, because the budget right now is already
already approved.
For,
yes.
Right.
Do you recall what the number was pre-increase? You know, before we've decided we've got an increase coming, what the old number was?
Of
the budget?
Yeah.
It's the budget that was approved by the...
The 556 million, whatever.
Right,
well,
right.
Because we went back and took out the... teacher's aides that we added in.
Right.
We took that effectively out of the rest of the dollars. And until the union contracts are settled, those numbers that we gave you were all estimates.
Right.
So,
and that's not done yet.
That's not done yet. So I mean, we're kind of in the middle of settling everything. I'm always comfortable with the budget numbers that we use for salaries and benefits, because as big as we are, my average salaries work out fine. I don't have concern that way. But as far as, you know, down to the penny, can I tell you that at this moment? No.
I don't know if necessarily I was looking for a down to the penny answer, but
well, the we know how many students we were projected in our budget on, and that's what the board approved the budget on.
Right.
When we approved the budget, remember there was some unallocated, which we went back and approved the teacher assistants, and that basically used everything we had left. So in my mind, that's why we're here, because, and Carmen knows, I'm not saying anything today that I haven't said to Carmen, that at this point in time, the general operating budget has all been allocated out.
So there is nothing. So the only money we're talking about then is whatever that increase is going to be.
That's
I mean, we don't know what
that is. Correct.
We don't know what that amount is.
That is correct. We will know, because we just completed FTE time period. So when we get our FTE reports in, we will know how many students were over the projection that was given to us at the beginning of the year by the state, of which we did a balanced budget.
And that we would expect that amount would be more than $30,000. So
yeah,
but you also have to remember that additional funding comes in will be for other things that other people may be requesting from us that we have on the agenda today. So that's what you have. That's why I brought that issue up.
And I did.
So everybody can remember, we only have this small pot.
Right, and Carol's right. So as we've had increased enrollment, we've had to put resources out into the schools, because we've had to add, and we added teachers for that. We added all those resources that the schools earn by the allocation formula. And that allocation formula is all built on the projected FTE that we receive once students enroll into our district and they meet the qualifications to be counted for FTE. What makes it difficult, not that we are evading the question at all, but, you know, there was a major count done here about a week and a half ago, and so everything has been shipped up to Tallahassee. In fact, all of it they're vetting through right now. So until we get our final report on that, we can't answer that question. We can predict what it will be based on the data we shipped up there, but they actually do the numbers and run through that. So nothing is set in stone until they come and say, here's how much money you're getting.
Well, this is where I'm having this internal struggle, because I absolutely agree with the merits of this position. I absolutely understand completely the benefits that the Educational Foundation brings to Lake County, and I want to do everything I can to support and enrich the foundation. Absolutely, no question in my mind. But I don't know how much money we've got.
Right. And today is not for you to take action. This is an information.
Learning.
This was an opportunity. It's a workshop. It's an opportunity for Carmen to present.
So it's not on the agenda for tonight?
No, this is not on the agenda for tonight.
I just sworn I saw it. Okay.
No.
All right.
This was for Carmen to come and give you the data and the information, what the pros are, what the impact to the district is. If you weren't interested in this at all, because in your mind you have other initiatives that you want that are of a higher priority, this is the time for you all to discuss that. But based on that, then we will bring, once we have final numbers, we'll be able to bring, you know, this will be put on an evening agenda for you to take action for.
Okay. Bill.
But you need to ask your questions and guide us.
First, I think that my first comment is that $30,967 as a salary is pretty low, by the way. then I would say to you, why would we not make this like a commission position where as one cultivates and generates dollars that we then pay it from those funds that are going to be coming in and that it not affect us at all?
Good question. And that's, I think you tried to address, because that was the question I had.
I heard the part about the grants and them being encumbered.
Right.
But we now are taking someone who is going to be solely to develop funds for the Education Foundation, to nurture existing relationships. Right. But also, why couldn't we make it, if you're nurturing, you're also developing?
Yes.
And then let's make that a commission job that's paid for by, and they're enriched by how much they bring in. And we don't, because $30,000 doesn't seem, if we wanted to seed a job and started at 30 so they had at least a base, like a guarantee to start with, I might be okay with that. But if you're really going to get someone who's really going to develop where I think your spirit has always been, then this isn't going to be that motivating dollar amount. I'm just telling you. And so then you then want to make it where it's commission so that they have benefited of the fruit of their work.
Yeah.
That's where my head would be, is that we don't deal with this at all and that there be a structure where if we needed to give some kind of guarantee to get it started, but then that person, quite honestly, is going to be a 90-day and you're going to get rid of them if they're not selling. I mean, legit, yeah. It would be a different structure.
But it's like real estate agent.
They can't be a school board employee on a commission salary. That would have to be.
Y'all going to have to talk in the mics.
Why do they have to even be a school board employee? Why can't we do them as a independent
first
agent.
Issue is that to avoid workers' comp insurance and foundation, we cannot have more than 3 employees, and we have 2 part-time employees that are working with Take Stock, and we have one that's working with the high school high-tech $30,000 grant that we have, so I cannot add any more foundation employees because I am a foundation employee.
Then why couldn't they be an independent where we 1099 them to start with? And then let them pay their expenses, make the commission where you can make some reasonable money.
I would love to do
that. I'll volunteer.
I would love to do that. However, our accountants and auditors will not allow it because we are directing their scope of work.
They're not independent contractors.
Yeah.
They really?
They have these requirements now.
Yeah. Man.
No, I tried that last week, Bill. I didn't. I mean, the one thing I can show is the history. I understand the needs of the district, and I understand that you need people in the classrooms, which obviously is most important. But I mean, we have a history. We've shown when we added one staff member, we had a return of 250 back in 2007. When we added the fourth staff member, we had a return of 396 back in 2014. I mean, we are talking about a 13-time return on your investment. And our hands are basically tied. We cannot fund any more salaries because we are paying all of mine. We are paying 30% of one of the Take Stocks, and we're paying 50% of another salary.
So it's not allowed in your position, and it's not allowed as a school district employee to be on a commission basis, because this is a great idea.
It is a great idea. But
I think
wrong.
The 1099 isn't, I think Mr. you can do Turner. A workaround on the 1099, that you're absolutely correct that if you were given specific direction to someone, they're technically an employee, not a 1099. But in this particular case, this is a commission sort of job. It's developing. You're going to give them a list of donors and potential donors. And then to be honest with you, I would encourage you not to worry about them. But let them go and sell. And then they just come back with the fruits of their work.
Well, and there is also the donor database, which is critical. So that's a lot of clerical in there. The stewardship, the picking up the phone calls, you know, and saying, wow, you know, you didn't volunteer the last time. So, yes, there is potential for development, Bill. And normally you can take a volunteer and move a volunteer into a small donor, you know, and then maybe get an estate plan out of them. So it's not like this person's going to walk out and, you know, bring in $50,000 a month.
But if you have the commission structured right where you're attracting that right person, you might. That's all I'm saying.
If I can interject.
Yes, ma'am.
The sales position is not in the same realm of you hiring somebody and going out and selling pots and pans and equipment like your business is. With a 501c3 corporation, when you are cultivating donors, you are working with donors, you are getting them to give. So much of the time, a donor will say, I will give $100, but I want it to go for grants for great ideas. I'll give $100, but I want it to go towards the Apple Mart. Very few people, and Carmen had shared this earlier, unrestricted dollars, which means it's not restricted for any specific area of what the Ed Foundation does. That's where people want it to go. They don't want it to go to unrestricted.
Right.
Because people want to say, my donation, I want to see it benefiting X. And so if we made this a commission-based position, it's not going to pay for itself. It won't pay for itself. Because then if the community finds out that this person is working based off of a commission, then the Ed Foundation is going to be seen in a completely different light.
Then I would question, and I don't disagree with anything you just said, $30,000, I don't know what you're going to get for that.
Well, and I agree with you on that. That is...
Yeah, because that's a lot of hard work.
I mean, Bill, it is in line with my other staff members to hire higher. Mm-hmm. We've had people working in that range for 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions for Carmen? Anything else you want to say, Carmen?
I understand that it might take longer to come to terms with the foundation position, but the take stock position, since it's fully funded from the state, if we could get action on that just as soon as possible, I would certainly appreciate it.
We can move that to an agenda item. Okay.
Well, and at this point in time, because the agenda for tonight has already been set, the next opportunity to bring would be the November 9th meeting. And we will be also looking at our FTE report. So it may be that we have that figure by then as well. And so, it may be that we can still do both at the same time. But if you were absolutely not interested in moving forward, I certainly am not going to pull staff time to do that. But I do hear, understanding of where we are headed.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
I have served on the Ed Foundation board since 1999. I have been the liaison from this board to the Ed Foundation board on and off for the past 7 years. I do what Carmen does for Lake Sumter State College. And so Carmen puts on some outstanding events each and every year. Organizing these events takes hours and hours upon hours on end. And so to be able to provide Carmen and her staff with another staff person, it's really not adding to because it's not as many people as she had a few years back, that it would allow Carmen to focus on things that, as the executive director, she should be focusing on, and less on some of these other items. And so I would just like to, ask people to really look at this seriously and to please ask any questions that you may have, because you all have seen what the Ed Foundation does for Lake County Schools and what it has done over the years. The more dollars that can be brought in means more dollars that are going to go into our schools. Three people cannot possibly do everything that needs to be done in also taking care of the books, preparing for the audit and the 990 report, and sending out all the acknowledgement letters and the donation letters so people get it for their tax deductions. They do an outstanding job for what they have.
And I think all of us up here understand that and know that. So thank you.
I'm not sure what we said. What did we say we're going to do? The
staff is
going to
go
sure.
back, yes.
At a minimum, we will bring back the foundation, the textile
right.
children on the
right.
next meeting.
Yes.
Right. And if we have the other information available, we'll bring them both to you at the same time.
Right. I'd like a little deeper dive into the 1099 concept. Yeah. And respecting the part
sure.
you're saying, too.
Well,
I don't disagree.
The problem we run into is what Carmen was trying to explain about the workers' comp. They can't be a school board employee on a 1099 or commission.
100% got that.
The foundation adds another person. They then fall under the coverage of workers' comp, and that's a huge expense to them. Mm-hmm. That's the problem
but is
they
that
have with adding a fourth employee. Doesn't matter what that employee's doing.
Mm-hmm. I get it. I'm just not buying it.
Just dig a little deeper is what he's saying. Okay. And we will do that. And board members, and I want to go back to something Mr. Dodd said, because I do think you and I both have had this conversation about maximizing dollars to the classroom, maximizing dollars to the classroom. And I'm very protective of we used every penny of this budget. And again, with the increased enrollment, that we do know that there will be increased revenue coming in. The question that is out there is that based on the resources we had to put in the school setting to address the increase in the
right.
enrollment,
right.
is there any extra revenue above and beyond what our expenses were? That's the question that we will be answering. And I know the needs across our district from the operating budget are great. And I have held the line to say, no, no, no. In this situation, I work with the foundation too. What they do and the philosophy of this foundation board is that everything they're doing, they are so particular about how they use their resources. Their number one priority in the board unanimously, it goes back to teachers in the classroom. And for that reason, what we're doing is they can't hire another employee because of all the reasons that they said, unless this deeper look tells us something different. But at this point in time, we're using resources because we can do that. But they're going to generate way more than the $30,000 that would go directly
right.
back into the classroom because of the requirements of theirs. So it really does give a win. And because they're a direct support organization of us, we're all together for all practical purposes, serving the classroom and the students that are in our classrooms. We're using our money much more strategically, working together. So in that reason, that is why I am supporting it. And in Carmen being here is that I wanted to be very transparent, and you've asked me to give all sides of it. So I did that.
Can I just ask? It's me.
It is you.
Can I just use my teacher voice?
Sure.
Can we not take one of the other employees? You said you've got the other employees that are generating the same salary. Give you the opportunity to hire another employer?
I'm still stuck with the same thing, unrestricted dollars.
And that's what you, so it's the unrestricted dollar, and to be honest with you, like, listening to conversations about, like, we're making phone calls, and we're just saying, hey, thank you for coming out, and this is coming up with the interest on, and it's a bit stressful here, it's very different. Mm-hmm. So it's more than restricted, the 1099
yep.
I would have to use to pay the 1099 and pay commission. First of all, I'd have to, they would have to be hired as a foundation employee.
Carmen, can you get your mic? They can't hear you.
We just had a ruling on that bill by the auditor and the accountant because we were trying to, Roseanne was part of that meeting and discussion, we were trying to bring one in for take stock until this could get approved from the board. And she was like, absolutely not, because you cannot direct that program or that employee. Then we are back to, if we're funding it and it's a commission, we're back to the same place. We don't have the unrestricted dollars to fund the position. I mean, it took a big toll on us last year when that position went dark. I mean, we all just, you know, bellied up to the bar and got more work to try to spread it and to keep it afloat. You know, but we are past capacity.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for your time.
November
Thank
9th.
You.
Anybody wants to come to the field?
Thank you, Carmen.
Okay, Dr. Moxley.
Okay, the next item is the textbook manager update. Carmen Arnold is in the audience along with Dr. Harris, who is our textbook manager, and I see Kathleen Jarvis is here as well. This past year, at the beginning of the year, thank you, Carmen, we moved the oversight of textbooks to curriculum and instruction. In the past, it was in professional development, and you received the recommendations from Mr. Mock when he did the audit on the instructional materials in the professional development audit. Some really good recommendations that we took to heart, and thank you for allowing us to have the textbook manager position. These two ladies on either end of Dr. Harris, thank you immensely for that, because they were picking that up along with all their other responsibilities in the K through 12 curriculum and instruction arena. Before Dr. Harris came on board, Mrs. Arnold and Mrs. Jarvis, they really took the textbooks by the helm. They took the audit report, they looked at the recommendations, and they actually dove into that very intensely. And they looked at systems that had been used in the past, systems that may be non-existent, and they have now provided the leadership, and Dr. Harris came on board. She jumped in, and what a quick study she has been. She has wrapped her arms around this enormous component of our organization, along with a massive adoption for us. And so she has developed systems, she's developed protocols, she's revised some of the manuals and those kinds of things. So today it's very fitting for us to hear from these three individuals the work that has been done, the systems that they're putting in place, how they've communicated that out to the schools, and what some of the next steps are. So I'm going to turn it over to them.
Well, I'm going to make one comment first. I wanted to thank the board, because this was one of those items that we weren't sure that we wanted this position or not, but we took the recommendations from Mr. Mock. It's a return on investment here. And he went in and showed us the items that needed to be clarified and that we did need the position. And I want to thank the board for seeing that through. And I had them put this on here so that you could see the fruits of your labors for approving that position. Doctor.
All right, and you need to make sure that the mic is up close so people can hear you.
Yeah. Okay. Can you hear this? Can you hear me? Can you hear
No,
me?
You're real quiet.
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. All right, good afternoon, Madam Chairman and board members, as well as Dr. Moxley. I just wanted to take you guys through.
Yes, ma'am, it's on. It's on.
You're going to have to get it closer.
And talk loud.
All right. Is that better?
Yes.
I feel like I'm going to be yelling, but.
That's okay.
Okay. Yell. All right. So I'm going to yell. I want to take you guys through just the initial, my first day on the job, to where we are currently. There's the handout, and you also have the PowerPoint. It's just going to summarize what your actual handout details. I would reference you here as the board just captures what I am talking about. Immediately, my first day on the job, August 10th, immediately we introduced this process to the principals at the principals meeting and informed them of the steps that we would take as a curriculum department to work with instructional materials for the first time in Lake County's history. Immediately brought onto the job, I have processed over 200 outstanding purchase orders and invoices. That's a mixture of our Envision as well as those that has been pending. I have, and we have, ordered 10 courses of state-adopted textbooks for the new courses, mainly AP and CTE courses, and also we've addressed the growth due to student enrollment. We've also immediately, I've had to schedule Destiny training. So we had to make sure that we brought Follett in, and they conducted a two-day training session with the textbook managers, and then I replicated that same system with the media specialists. That's immediately on the job in August. Currently, starting in September, I've also updated the principals at the principals meeting as to where we were. with what you saw as immediate actions. Simultaneously, I'm going through Skyward training to make sure I have the appropriate training in budgets, transfers, requisitions, and staying in contact with our vendors, knowing who our vendors are, and then picking up the phone and introducing myself personally to make sure they knew that I was on the job and whom to contact if they had any concerns. Fall at training we had for the textbook managers, I went through that same webinar and phone conversation training as well. Made sure that I understood the system, the process, and what to look for and how to train our capacity builders. Also, I had to learn the process for integration for our online curriculum, which we're going to talk about with Pearson, McGraw-Hill, as well as HMH. Also, I went through several training with the barcoding and also course code and in-service. Served as a program specialist here for 2 years prior to, this is a whole new ball game. So I had to make sure I had the proper training as well. Now, this is just a summary of what you have in front of you, but I'm at the section that details Destiny Professional Development. We, based on the audit, we wanted to be sure to provide training that the audit recommends to become more efficient and effective users of our inventory system. There are components of Destiny that were not tapped into, and we wanted to make sure that the textbook managers, as well as the media specialists, because we have some that are new to the position this year, and then some that are returning just 1 or 2 years, and they had not had formal training on the system. So we had to ensure that we started off on the same page. 43 textbook managers, 43 media specialists to date have been trained. We also have launched a Destiny Lost Textbook Inventory Cleanup. This is a part of the audit that we received. And if you will look at your second handout, your first handout, is just me and the directors here going through and mapping out what our course of action is going to be for this first quarter. Okay, so that's the first handout, that I didn't reference that I should have. The second handout. What I put together here is really a timeline to get us out of the red. Now, outside of Lake County Schools, I'm also a business owner, and it really was something that I took on personally, I would say, when I saw the outstanding fees when it came to textbooks and those that were listed as lost, and knowing that they're not really lost, they're on the shelves somewhere. So I've launched the Destiny Cleanup Action that I've shared with our textbook managers. And we're doing this in 5 phases. The first phase, based on our training that we had with Follette, textbook managers, if they are listed in their 16 school site in phase one, your second handout, they're going to go into the system personally, just as they have been trained, and they're going to locate 5 years of outstanding textbooks that are no longer on the shelf. They are indeed lost. And they're going to delete those textbooks from the server. So that's training that we had, and that's our first bullet points. School site configuration. We had to empower, and I had to make sure the textbook managers were well-versed in deleting textbooks and go through that process with them. We have a 2-week window on phase one, all right? By the time we have our conference, I am working with Follette in conferencing bi-weekly, just to make sure, as a new person to this position, I'm utilizing their support and they're walking me through the process, making sure that I stay on point, and also hold the textbook managers accountable as well to assist us with our lost inventory cleanup. Phase two, we have 37 schools here in Lake County that have over 1,653 lost titles dated back 5 years that they are off the adoption list. We need to clean those up, get them off of our shelves. So once we are done with phase one, phase two will be those textbook managers going in and cleaning up those inventories. That's off adoption. The third phase will be, because it's a much larger count, Follette will work with our IT department, and who have worked with us very closely throughout this process, to ensure that the 4,000 books that are listed here that are lost throughout our school, they will go in and assist us with deleting those items as well. Okay? The fourth phase, again, lost textbooks that have no identifier. They don't have a barcode, ISBN number. They're just in the system, and they are truly lost. They're also going to wipe those clean. The last phase that we're going to do and launch sometime at the end of the year, or as soon as we return from winter break, is going to launch an inventory. Now that we have an actual count of our books, we know what we have on campus and what we do not have on campus, we're going to ask each textbook manager to inventory their materials. Myself and Panika Wells, who's the inventory specialist, she and I have been already doing campus visits, and at that time we will make sure that we're visiting the campus and assisting those textbook managers and walking them through the process. So that's how we are going to get to a point when we know exactly where we are as a district with the lost textbooks. Those are the five phases. Okay, so accomplished to date, I'm back on the handout here. And right now, based on the audit finding to develop policies, procedures, and protocols to become more efficient operation, I have put in place procedures and protocols for communication with the new manager's position. Now this position, I had to go through and start, I would say, from scratch. Basic phone communication, email communication. I didn't assume that everyone knew how to complete a requisition. So during our training in September, the 24th and 25th with the textbook managers, I actually went live with a requisition form, walked them through how to complete it completely the right way, and to send the information that is required to locate and to purchase the items that they needed. Once we went through that process, I then explained to them the order of approval. I then walked them through contacting the vendor, also getting it approved at the level with the directors, then how it goes on to finance, then it goes on to procurement, and then also with ordering it and getting it on their campus. See, there were misconceptions out there, and they just thought it was a turnaround time. You know, they put in a requisition, and then it'll be at their door magically the next day. So I had to explain to them it is indeed a process. So that information has been process and procedures updated in our textbook manual. And this is the manual that has been completed with the assistance of a collaboration team that I put together of textbook managers that have had over 15 years of experience. They work very closely with me to ensure that this was indeed something that would help us and keep us steered in the right direction. So this is ready to go to press, ready to print, have been approved, and ready to go. But those are just some of those protocols and procedures that had to be put in place to make sure that everybody was on the same page.
I want to add something too, because up until these protocols and procedures, and we've had procedures, the problem is that it was easier to pick up the phone and let me just call, I need two math books.
Right.
Well, what math book? Which one? Which grade level? Which, you know, is it this book or is it this book? And then those would get ordered and sent. But the problem is that without the formalized system,
right,
and a requisition, you don't, you know, you're somebody by hand is having to go back and find out, okay, we've got to apply this to this school,
right,
this budget, and did it get into Destiny? And so,
right,
we have things that aren't in Destiny. So through Faith's work, we now will have an accurate Destiny system with everything in a procedure and a protocol. And so that's why she's working through the textbook manager.
Yes.
So if I am XYZ staff person at a school, I need to work through my textbook manager.
Yes.
So the textbook manager puts a requisition in, it comes over. And all this is electronic, so it's not a delay. It's just that we have one contact for each school,
yes,
and it's streamlining it, and then it's getting barcoded and put in Destiny as it's being processed. And
yes,
so that's critically important that we have those, and everybody follows those protocols.
Most definitely.
Is that manual available electronically?
It will be. The textbook managers have requested that this is something that's placed online on our website. And that's one of my larger items to complete as well, update the instructional website, instructional materials website. So it will be live.
All right.
It will be once we publish.
When it goes electronic, I like to read it.
Sure.
All right.
Sure.
Thanks.
Thing. Mm-hmm. Most definitely. And with what Dr. Moxley mentioned, inventory was there and available in their schools. But because the process and procedures were not in place,
right,
there were reordering of 500 books that we didn't have to reorder. So literally we have saved thousands of dollars to date with just 2.5 months because they've had the proper training. They know how to go into Destiny and how to look up inventory. And they have been calling each other and driving to each other's school to get these much needed textbooks, as well as we also conduct the transfer process for them and with them. So it has really been a time saver to have this in place for them. Media specialist handbooks are being updated as well as we speak. It'll talk about those up-to-date protocols as well. And media specialist collaboration team assisted me in this process as well. Going on with our textbook, where we are to date accomplishments, I've talked about the lost and damaged textbooks, also generating reports so that they could know exactly what it is they need to do. 612 math adoption. So I've been working with this simultaneously with Ms. Jarvis here. And as you can see, the flow map that talks about just what this process looks like and what we have been doing as a team, starting with the use of our content program specialist. And I won't read each block, but it will bring you to date where we are. This second handout will give you kind of an overview of what the adoption process is like. This is my first adoption with secondary. Next year, we're looking forward to a couple more adoptions. It's extremely time consuming because we want to make sure that we're doing things the right way. So I'll just give you a minute if you'd like to look over what that adoption process is like here in Lake.
Go ahead, Bill.
I'm going to ask a question while they're looking over it.
Sure.
One of the guiding principles that led me to the vote for this position was also was really tied to the electronic and that that those licenses, and there was going to be opportunities there, but I don't see that addressed. Is that coming? Okay.
It's coming.
It's coming.
We wanted to make sure the public heard.
Yes.
That you got your answer.
And it's coming because IT held our hand.
Yes.
Thank you, IT.
Yes, thank you.
In the process over here on the second page, it's yes. The publisher's videos online showcase to be.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Is that when the teachers at the schools are going to look at the textbooks for adoption purposes?
Well, currently, the window is open where the textbooks have been purchased and they're at their school for the committee reviews from last week until this week. This week, Friday, once they vote on their curriculum, their top two or top three, we're then going to provide a publisher's video next week if we have close rankings. So that publisher's video is intended to assist them in making a more informed choice and decision on their textbook. So that will be launched next week.
Okay.
Our goal with the math adoption is to have this completed into the board by the end of this year so that next year we can continue with our foreign language adoption for secondary. So that's our goal. Okay, to continue on, we have also with allocations have distributed the state media funds, allocation funds, as well as the district media allocation funds, K-12. Making sure that with the state funds, the media specialists are up to date with the state adopted materials, with the tools and digital supplemental items that is needed for the classroom. The district media, making sure that they are as well up to par with the collections, fictions, nonfictions, those books that they shelf as well. My goal, I continue to approve and monitor those funds. They have to submit a form and share how they're going to utilize those resources on their campus. That's aligned with the state and district expectation, as well as distribution of the state lab materials for the K-12 as well. This involves science consumables, experiments, hands-on, those types of things that will help science and STEM objectives here in Lake County as well as in the state of Florida. So those have been distributed as well. Currently, I have been working to organize, plan, and implement with our textbook adoption, the online platform as well. So I have met with Pearson, HMH, and McGraw-Hill, their consultants, and have launched these three single sign-on platform, which has been in itself a lot of work because the idea of streamlining is to make it more accessible and easy for the students as well as the parents and teachers to access. But you know, with technology, you have to just be very, very patient. Right now, I've been working with the IT department, shout outs, that has been very, very helpful through this entire process. So very appreciative with the collaboration amongst the curriculum team as well as IT to get this launched and off the floor. Still some things we have to work through, but we're working through those. I coordinate, again, meetings with the vendors and those departments. Something else that I have been working on and I believe have accomplished and moving forward with is repairing relationships with the textbook vendors and warehouse, again, personally making those calls, introducing myself, and if there are any outstanding requisitions or invoices, unpaid bills, making sure that those are paid up with highest apologies and moving forward. So that's something that I have been working on daily. If you turn to the second page, just moving on towards our future. Our future entails additional textbook adoption. The first thing, we're continuing on with the Destiny cleanup, making sure that we clean up those lost textbook and launch our inventory in January to get a more accurate read on our textbooks and where we are to date. We anticipate adopting Spanish 912, and we're looking at future adoptions of CTE, HOPE, and personal fitness based on the state expectations there as well. Quarterly professional learning and support for our textbook managers and media specialists. I want to make sure that I'm meeting with them face-to-face just to support in what they're doing, to give them the opportunities for professional learning, sharing best practices, and then supporting whatever needs that they have. Organizing and implementing on-site visits, which have already started, but I want to be at all 43 sites. And I know I'm one person, but this is something that's possible. I'm high on organization, so I'm about to just make sure that at least each site has 30 minutes of, here I am, what do you need, how can we help you move this inventory and ensure that every student has the books that they need. So we're working that out and looking at January 2016 to make sure that all schools are physically supported as well. I'm monitoring the implementation of the process, protocols, and procedures, making sure that what we put in place is being followed and followed through and followed up on. So that's something that I want to make sure that I do. Future goal is to work very closely with our growth and planning department to calculate projections to make sure that we don't come across some of the things that we have been experiencing my first month here, shortage on those important math textbooks and ELA books. I want to make sure we have more than enough materials to start the new school year. So this is, again, a snapshot of what I have been doing since I've landed this awesome position that I'm excited about each and every day. So thank you for your time.
And it appears you're doing an awesome job already, so that's
thank you.
Great. Yes, ma'am.
One of the things that I
can you try your mic again?
I can, and I put technology and everything.
Okay.
One of the things that I don't see, and some of it can pull onto what Mr. Mathias mentioned a minute ago about the licensing, but mm-hmm. you mentioned that you guys worked on the single sign-on with the online component of the textbooks, which
yes.
is such a significant piece. And I know on our last software committee meeting, we had a request from a school for a purchase of a program that sounded very similar to what our textbook features are offering. So who is owning what those textbook online pieces look like and what they can offer to schools to ensure that we're not licensing these outside products at individual school sites that are actually something that is in this single sign-on? Who's owning that?
I can address that.
From the curriculum department, we have to take a look at in the software committee that whatever is in the curriculum department, whatever is in the textbook and Basel arena, then what something new comes in. That's why we need to ask hard questions and have those difficult conversations. Are you duplicating something that's already offered? Is it something that you have academic data to show that this product improved academic performance at your school? Or is it just another, quote, fluffy piece?
But we did ask those. I mean, we did ask, you know, they had some results from another county. And when I asked, is this something that is on our online component, nobody could answer that question.
What
and we don't want to hold a school up from
correct.
Getting something that they need, especially when their science scores were what they were. But
what we may need to do to that, I understand where you're coming from, is we may need to ask from the software committee as well as the curriculum department that the school meet with us and do a crossover mm-hmm. before asking for an outside piece of software. Have you done that cross and over and walk through of this piece to what we already have? If the school is requesting it, I personally feel it's their responsibility to have done their homework.
Right.
I think the other thing is that when textbooks are up for adoption, like, for example, the 612 mathematics,
right,
and we're going through that process now, when we should know exactly what components are available and included in that textbook adoption. And I think now with what Dr. Harris is doing and her critical eye, we're able to better identify those components. Then at that point in time, that can be communicated out so that when they schools do bring things to the software committee. So part of it is, we have silos going on here, and it's that ability to communicate across. And when we're not all in one location and we're in different towns, sometimes the message gets lost in the communication there. But I think that with the organization that Dr. Harris has put in place now, we can clearly articulate, here's what this math adoption or here's what the Spanish adoption has, so that as the schools are now bringing forth their initiatives, I do agree with Mrs. Arnold, they need to go then to the list. Here's what's included in the Spanish, if this, or here's what's included in math. Is there, maybe that's available and I didn't realize it was, I don't need to do this. But the stopgap and the checks and balances does come through the software committee, which I know that Mrs. Arnold and we have curriculum representation there. Now, they just went back through, and they established some protocols, and those have been updated here within the last 30 days, some protocols as well. So
yeah, I remember we went over them. I just see that, and I've gone through a textbook adoption twice, so I get that. And we had it available in 2008 when we did our textbook adoption last time, and we went over the online components. And that's one of the reasons I specifically asked about the 2 days with the video, because I know the textbook adoption is concerning regardless of all the work that gets put in it, just because what is the actual amount of time that somebody looks into it, in addition to some of the other things that they have going on. So we know what's available, and we're telling them what's available, but we're still having these, it's still happening 10 years later is what my point is, and online's coming online.
Right.
And maybe it is that, I mean, I like the piece where, I know you guys were on the software committee, and I was in too, but the question still isn't being answered. And
so the question I would have to ask, and maybe there's some more information you can shed on this, 10 years ago we did not have a software committee. In fact, when Dr. Wheeler came on board three and a half, four years ago, we had just done an inventory of all the software that was out in the schools. That took us a long time, but we had gotten that done, and he came in and inherited a list about yay thick. And so then we started vetting through that, and we put the software committee. So the software committee has been in place, well, I'd say about 3.5 years now. And so the question is that are we not seeing any improvement since the software committee is in place? There should be some improvement over 10 years ago. But then the question is that if there's not, then we got to go back and say, well, then what's going on in the software committee? Because that was part of the intention of having the software committee put in place, was so that we needed to whittle down this list and find things sitting on the shelf, still not used, and yet we're ordering more copies over here at this school because they're choosing to use it, that was to be the gatekeeper.
Right. So this was the software committee that we just had on October 8th that I'm speaking about, and we were talking about science. And the textbook for science has an online component. It does. It has an online component. And so they're talking about purchasing software that they can bring into the school because their science scores were bad last year, and they're wanting to improve it, and the teachers came forward with this. And so I said, well, is this available with the textbook? And that we didn't know.
So at that point in time, what should have occurred is that before we can move forward with this request, we need to answer the question, is there duplication with the science textbook and the online material? And so in the software committee meeting, what should have occurred is that we need to table this, and who is going to own the next steps of going to get the answer to that question? Oh, we need to contact Dr. Harris. Dr. Harris needs to be put on the next meeting agenda to come in and address and be prepared to research, you know, have researched it and answer these questions.
Right.
Now, I don't want to second guess what took place at the audit committee.
I can tell you
software committee, but if you don't know the answer, we shouldn't be moving forward and approving it. We should go find the answer.
But then the problem was, and this is what the principal expressed, was then I have to wait for another software committee meeting to get the results, and then I have to wait again to get it ordered. So I'm not going to have this program in place now until February, March, mm-hmm. which is another, I mean, that's a grave concern, too. So I think we're trying to, and correct me if I'm wrong, people are on this committee with me, too, and I'm rather new to it. But the problem is we don't want to hold up something that could be potentially effective, especially when the school that we're speaking about did really struggle in science. So they do need something now. But what is it that we need? You know, I mean, yeah. I get it. Yeah. I agree with you. That's yeah. what should have happened.
And I realize that, hindsight's 20/20.
Sure.
So it's always good vision at that point in time. But, again, that is a meeting we control. And so with Safari Montage, telephone conferencing, all those kinds of things, there is no reason that we could not have said, let's schedule a follow-up conference call or webinar 2 days from now to have the answer, because we don't want to hold that up. There's nothing stopping us from doing that.
Mm-hmm. That would be a good end all. Because I think that, and I see it across all of our textbooks. This was just one example that just came up. I mean, it was the most recent that I can think of. The other thing I don't see on here in regards to the online textbook that we seem to get hung up on every year is that transition from we have the students in the system and then we need to wipe the system out to get it started back for the fall. And when we're looking at your timeline of things that are coming up in the future, that is a huge area to make sure that it's ready, because we don't have it ready at the beginning of the school year. I know that that can be a problem.
Okay, two things. With the science textbooks, if you're referring to the Earth, space science, the physical science, those are all the state-adopted textbooks that are on McGraw-Hill. So with that process, I have been communicating with the principals as well as the textbook managers, keeping them up to date with this is where we are in the process. So it has launched officially 2 weeks ago, and it is available online. We're having a difficult time with the McGraw-Hill platform. So teachers have accessed it. It's not us as a district. I have been working very closely with Lisa Davies, the McGraw-Hill rep, as well as Josh, the IT for McGraw-Hill, to get through these issues with the science online curriculum.
Good.
What the instructional website will do is only it will host those adopted state textbooks online platform. So right now, Lake County schools have those supplemental items available that students and teachers could log into, but the instructional materials website will host the science, the McGraw-Hill, the Pearson, the HMH. So that's what I want to do, is to make it more accessible where the students, the parents, the teachers sure. know where to go. It's not there yet, but that's what we're working on to make sure that they know where to go to access it. But it has officially launched. I just wanted you to know that.
Good.
The second concern that you shared, this is what single sign-on is designed to do, is to isolate that. If a student transfers, if a teacher drops, it will automatically do this in the system.
Good.
There's a nightly update.
Good.
Right, it's brand new this year as well. There's a nightly update that takes place that once a student transfers or is dropped, that system will automatically do that update. That's kind of the beauty of single sign-on. But again, it's just taking some work to just make sure everything is ironed out. And it's working right. seamlessly.
Good. And who? Oh, I'm sorry.
Got another one?
Nope. You want to go? I can take a break.
Mine, I think, was a quick one. In regards to the notification of how to access the online textbooks, I want to say that's actually a state statute that we are supposed to send home some sort of notification.
Yes.
Is something like that coming? Or at what point do? I don't know if there's any timeline associated with that statute of when we have to do that, but. Mm-hmm. When does that happen?
That is by law, and what I have done is we have gone through the process with the principals and the textbook managers. The textbook managers supply their textbook plan, and they are responsible school-based to notify the parents of all textbooks, updates, and adoption. So it's the responsibility of each textbook manager to say, hey, we've launched Pearson. Be sure that you access this via my portal. So that is a requirement by state law, and textbook managers have been doing that. That's per school.
All right. Dr. Moxley, you and I had a conversation about this ages ago, and one recommendation that I passed on then was
okay.
that in addition to those textbooks, you know, there are many other programs that students can access at home, iStation, iReady, you know, the list goes on and on and on. And one thing that I found as a parent of multiple grade level kids is that, you know, I get this paper about this one and this one from this teacher about this one, and then here comes another paper.
Okay.
And I can't keep track of it all. You know,
okay.
But you know, if that is all incorporated together with how I log on to each of the textbooks, as
okay.
well as here are all the online programs that I can use at home, That would be fantastic, I think, from a parent's perspective.
And that one we're still working on because it's across all departments in the district that touch students. So, yes, it's getting all of that that's there. But, yes, and your suggestion is very valid.
That's a good suggestion. Thank you.
Stephanie, do you have anything else?
Who determines the amount each school gets for their science allocation, for, like, their lab material?
Being new, I called the state, and I asked them, how do we distribute the consumables? And the lady told me, her name, oh, don't ask me right her name, is that in the consumable arena, with the emphasis that the state has put on STEM, hands-on, in the classroom, it should be distributed K-12. I took it upon myself to look at the amount of the dollars, speaking with DOE and asking them that this was the blanket procedure across the district, I mean, across the state, and then being sensitive that high schools do a little more in depth, but not ruling out that elementary definitely needed dollars for consumable for those teachers and those labs. They now all have their funds distributed. High school has more money than the others because of FTE and per dollar amount per FTE. Middle school per FTE, elementary a dollar per FTE. So each level got a degree of support to help with those that have the enrichment wheel science labs in the elementary, as well as classroom teachers in the middle school with your labs, and in the high school where they're doing the more dissection and the more hands-on, the chemistry, those pieces. They have now been all funded, and it's in the schools.
So it's per FTE of the student, not necessarily enrollment into a science course, or is it the FTE enrollment into a...
If a school had 3,000 kids, it's going to get 3,000 times the dollar mark versus a school with 600 kids. So it's more equitable. That was one of the state suggestions, to look at that equability as far as that. But our district being sensitive to knowing that we've placed higher expectations that our high schools take a look at their labs, funds were put into that for them because of that extra expense, and they've all been taken care of.
The high school got a higher ratio.
Right. Yes. Good.
And the one thing that... Then they go to the school, and so, you know, at a high school, you may, then it may, it's divided up among the science courses.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
And then they can decide, so for example, taking a high school example, if you do a rotation that you know every year you may need to replace beakers or microscopes or whatever it may be, you may, biology may get a greater pro rata share this year than chemistry, but that's we let the high schools decide.
But every school got it, K-12.
Correct, right? Correct, yes. Correct.
It's in their hands now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, any other questions for these ladies?
I just would like to say it's a pleasure to meet you. Thank you. You have done an enormous amount of work in a short period of time, and I know that you have us heading in the right direction. And I only see greater and greater things to come, so thank you.
Anyone else? Thank you very much for the report and the work.
Yes, thank you very much.
We're going to hear 3.04, and then we're going to take a 5-minute break.
Okay.
Doctor, is
that sure. Okay? your pleasure, Mrs. Stavender. We're good.
Okay.
We're going to have Harry Fix and Kelly Randolph come and present to you the information about a 10-acre parcel adjacent to our existing Woodlea property that we own. And this property has been designated as a future elementary school site. And there is adjacent property that we will talk about. So I'll turn it over to Kelly.
And you're going to have to speak right into it. It's acting up today.
Thank you, Madam Chair, board members, Dr. Moxley. This is a proposed purchase. It is 10 acres. It is adjacent to the Woodley school site that we obtained as part of the property swap with the county and the city of Tavares. I think that was in 2011. And it is designated for an elementary school site, although there has been some discussion among staff as to whether maybe we need to look at a K-8 for this as some partial relief for Tavares Middle School as well. But it is, you know, a future project. It's not within our current 5-year plan. It probably will at some point become within our next 10-year plan. But The purpose for this, the owners are asking $25,000 an acre, which is pretty reasonable. Our property, when we acquired the 20 acres, it appraised at about $62,000 an acre. So $25,000 an acre is reasonable for this property. And really the reason that we're looking at it seriously is that it gives us some flexibility for the future. Our ideal situation, and we've been talking to the city of Tiveres about this, is to extend, you see Captain Haynes Road there that's perpendicular to Woodley on the north side, would be to extend that road south through our property really to Slim Haywood Road, which is on the south. And that would give us some more flexibility on access. It would give us two major access points onto State Road 19. Right now, our access is where Harry's pointing, is along that west side of the city of Tiveres spray field through an easement through there. It's decent access. It's our ideal would really be to have a major road that runs north and south through the property, at which point we would probably have to give up some right-of-way and maybe some retention area as well. So having this extra 10 acres will give us a lot more flexibility in the future and give us a better building area and, you know, keep us at 20 plus acres.
These 10 acres, are they buildable acres?
Yes, ma'am. I mean, from everything.
Are there any wetlands to them?
No. From everything that we've looked at, we'll go through our normal due diligence process, have a geotechnical study done, have a phase one done. There are no wetlands from anything that we've been able to tell. It's not within the floodplain. If you look at our one, actually Mr. Mathias has it on the top there. It's got a big blue dot in the middle of the Woodley site. I don't think everybody was on the board when we did this. That is it's just a dip in the land. Right now it's on floodplain, but there's a process that we can go through called a letter of map revision, which would allow us to take that out of the floodplain. So it really, all of that property is really buildable. It just is a technical issue right now.
But just to point out, that's the property we currently have.
That's the property we currently have. The rest of it is actually higher and pretty dry. So we would go through that process of due diligence. We do the threatened and endangered species study, the geotechnical study, the phase one environmental study that we normally do. And as well, we would get an appraisal on it and make sure it actually came to $25,000 an acre. I'm not concerned about that. I think we can meet that price easily in an appraisal.
Harry, how many acres do we typically need for, and I mean, we haven't built a K-8 yet. I mean, we're in the process, but how many acres ideally do we want for a K-8?
This one's working. The 30 acres would be really, in this situation, I think very ideal, given, as Kelly stated, the fact that, I mean, we might have been able to do it on 25, but here, I think, given the fact that there's the possibility of that secondary road that the city had been talking about when we did the swap of bringing a road and then swinging it down through here, but definitely, you know, we have access here. If they do, or when they do, hopefully, that'll take up some more of the land there. But between the two, it just gives us greater flexibility. So I think that between those two possibilities, and if we had to do any on-site retention, that this would benefit us greatly. The other thing I was gonna say is, we can see from the aerial, this is a burned out orange grove, and we know that those lands are high dry lands because the roots of an orange tree couldn't take wet.
All right. But my question was, how many acres for a K-8? You said 30 would be the number, 25 would be ideal. We're looking at possibly 20 acres here. So are we going to have to look at additional land in order?
Presently we have 20 acres. This would add another 10 to it for a total of 30.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
On this calendar that I'm looking at here, there is a mid-county elementary school in 2025. Is that this?
That would be this.
Okay.
Right.
And but it's going to need to be sooner than that.
Ideally, we would move
I know.
That up,
I know. You know. ideals versus what we've got on paper. But I just want to. That's this.
That is
okay.
That project.
Any other questions? This is on the agenda tonight, correct?
Yes, ma'am. It is. The contract is on your agenda, and it becomes effective upon your approval.
But with all those caveats.
I've got another question. By purchasing this property, how quickly can we start working with whoever the entities are, with DOT and the county and Tavares, on looking at roadways?
We have actually already met with the city of Tavares to discuss it, and then we would be working with the county as well. Because the other factor is that in the best possible situation, we would like to widen or have, we would not do it, but have Woodley Road widened as well. It would provide
okay,
us.
Okay, and realistically.
A little bit better.
But we began those conversations even back when the property swap occurred
right.
as well.
Oh, I remember that because now we're 4 years later and there's nothing, nothing has been done to the roads in there. So, how long would, could we possibly see anything done to any roads back in there?
It would have to be placed in their five-year plan. I think really both entities are probably waiting on the sales tax vote to see what happens with that. So, that's going to affect the road work here as well. Mm-hmm. So I can't give you a good answer.
Right.
They would have to
That. It's just important to look at everything because we can say, okay, we now own 30 acres there, but then there's no roads. Now, how are we going to get the roads in there in order to build the school?
Right.
And, it all is a domino effect.
Absolutely. And one of the great things that, as we can do things like this, if we can have it out there for 5 to 6 years, it does allow for the city, just as we're doing, to start looking at this and putting it in that last year or what is the 6 year and start rolling it forward into their capital plan. And Kelly's absolutely spot on. And speaking with the city, they also are very dependent at looking at how this sales tax goes forward before they start committing what projects they might start being able to bring forward.
Speaking about roads, I'm looking at the map now that shows the rough location of the Captain Haynes Road extension. Mm-hmm. It seems to go right and cuts off a significant portion of our property.
That's a really rough drawing of where it would be. I mean, it would end up coming through the top northeast corner. Ideally, it would run.
So, looks like
there's houses in there.
Yeah. There is.
There is, and that would be part of the negotiations with the city on accessing those. So,
we got to look at all this.
No, I'm trying to detach myself from it because I am the one that has been talking to the city with staff on all this. And the suggestion was at the meeting we had with them is that it does come closer to the east, which would not cut off such a big chunk. And we would have to have retention anyway. So it would be, etched in stone. This is just an idea that came up when Don Griffey did this about 8 or 10 years ago. And if there were homes that needed to be, that are up for sale, that would be purchased, that would be a city of Tavares that would be doing the eminent domain for that. It would not be us. This is just a proposal to show you what could happen out there and what we would like to happen out there.
Right. But even without that road extension, we have access to the property. We have, it's adequate access. We can access it. We can run a road down along the side there and then put both a bus loop and a vehicle access off of it.
What was originally planned when we did it before.
Which is what was originally planned. So we have adequate access to it. Would we like better access? Certainly, of course. But that's something that we can negotiate and discuss.
And I think if it ends up being a K-8 to have two ways in and two ways out, which has been my concern with what we're looking at down at the four corners with that one in and one out, is going to be, I just would like to avoid that
sure.
at all costs.
Anyone else have?
Just to follow up on this 2033 timeline here, I don't see anything about adding middle school capacity, but that would be the plan here.
That was a that's okay. an initial discussion. The long range plan is flexible.
Right.
You know, it's something that gets amended every 5 years as we go through that process. But just looking at Tavares Middle School, it seems like there's a possibility that we would need some middle school capacity in this area, and adding a K-8 with, you know, a limited middle school instead of having to build a whole middle school may end up being a good solution in the future.
So since we've done this, we've since identified a need that potentially we do need some middle school relief.
A potential need, yes.
Okay.
And if you see, there are two, Mark, on that drawing that you've got in front of you.
Yeah.
The new Publix will be up and running, I was told yesterday, by October of next year. Since that has come in, they're redesigning the road and how it's coming off of 561 coming across to make that an entrance. There's been two new requests going to the city of Tavares for housing in that area. So the need is going to be there.
And we've seen growth at Tavares Middle School this year, a lot of growth at Tavares Middle School.
I mean, the elementary school's over.
Mm-hmm.
But it just seems logical to me that if, in the worst case, we needed 25 acres, we own 20, mm-hmm. this becomes sort of a duh moment for me.
mm-hmm. Everyone have their questions answered for tonight to be able to vote? Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, staff. And we're going to take five-minute break. And I think, why don't we...